Thank you very much. So a little about me. I started Cppcheck in 2007. I am the maintainer for the Cppcheck project. A little overview about Cppcheck testing. We have continuous integration, as I guess everybody has, and there is nothing special about it, so I will not talk about that much. We have fuzzing, and then we have distributed testing. About the testing, it can really matter a lot for a product if it will work well or not, so it's a very key feature of a project. I'll start with the fuzzing. We started fuzzing like this. A fuzzer generates various garbage, and we input that as code to Cppcheck, and then Cppcheck will crash in some seconds or so. It does crash actually quite easily with this approach. We don't handle garbage input very well. In theory, we should have input validation in Cppcheck so that the fuzzer generates garbage input, and then we have a syntax check that will just block that, and then the analyze part will not have to deal with the garbage. I don't want to handle garbage in the analyze step. And analyze, this is the critical part of Cppcheck, the analyze. This is why you run Cppcheck, and I want to focus all energy on analyze. I don't want to focus all energy on syntax check. You already have syntax checks in your compiler. If you want to avoid crashes, you can reuse your compiler to syntax check. So I don't promise that we will not crash. This is our current approach with fuzzing. We have a fuzzer that generates garbage. That garbage is converted into code. So every bit of garbage, if you have 24 bits of garbage, then we will convert every bit of that into code. So we can fuzz lots of valid input here. A minor problem here is that we don't fuzz all possible code. There is certain types of code that we never get through this method. Here is an example how it can look. There are 3 bytes, 24 bits of information that generates this code. And here is another example. Lots of I don't know, 100 bits of information, and you can go on. Sometimes the fuzzer generates 10 kilobytes of code, so it can get quite big. Then we have distributed testing in Cppcheck. In 2010, the Debian project started the run. They run Cppcheck on all their code, and they created a service there. So you could look at some web pages and see all the results. And I was super excited about that. Thought it was great, but the project was not alive for long. And then in 2013, I took this idea and started running this on my own computer.
So why did the project end?
Not sure. They lost interest. I think Rafael Geysert was a hero, and he liked this idea, but then it didn't get enough traction, so it was very sad. But it really helped us, so I created my own script and started running it on my own computer. My script would analyze all Debian source code, generate results, generate web pages, and those were uploaded to a web server as static content. And the problem with that was that CPU is a very limited resource. On a normal computer, it takes weeks to analyze Debian source code. And in 2018, I started a new script called daca at home, where contributors, anybody in the, you can, if you want to, when you go home, you can contribute here. You can donate CPU on your computer. You run a small, simple script. It says down here on the, I know that it's hard to see bottom half of the screen, unfortunately, but you can run these two commands and then you donate CPU.
And your promise is not a mining script?
No, I don't promise anything.
Which brings us to how the project is funded.
So I will show here how we run it. Here are current results. It's a real-time updated, so when I click on this I can see all the latest results that has been uploaded. So there are computers right now here and there in the world that is running, and I can go into any here and look at some results. So these are the results that generates on one computer. I can see up here what the platform it was, and ARM 7, it sounds like a Raspberry. And I get timing, I get, you will see a little more about that later, but here.
And is it a crash? What does it mean?
Yeah, that's a crash.
What crashed?
So this doesn't say much. I thought there would be a backtrace here actually, but usually we have backtrace for crashes. We are actually in a stabilization period right now. We want to release 1.90, but we will look at the crashes and stuff and try to fix as much as possible. So it should be relatively stable right now. Ruslan, I get permission to run this script on this computer. So this is how it looks. Here it analyzes EU ping, and the results was uploaded there. And I can immediately go here and here. This is the results that was created on this computer. Five warnings. And I can, yeah. So now I won't use the script anymore. You can relax.
And how about they have the name clear, the name conflict in the computer host name, or what's the name of the IOPing?
IOPing is a package, so each package in Debian has a unique. Aha, I take the unique from Debian, yeah.
There's nothing special about this build. There's no sanitizers or something like that.
No, not right now, but that is a good idea to add. Now, let's see if I...
No, doesn't help.
Thanks. So this is what happens. We have a number of clients in the world. We have one server. And each client will ask a command here, get package URL. And the server has a list of 30,000 URLs. So it will just send back one URL at a time. And each client will then download and unpack the package. It will pull Cppcheck head. It will analyze the code both with the latest release and head so that we can compare warnings. It will diff the results. It will generate a report and it will upload the report. So all this is done in a textual, very simple format. And the server also has a HTTP interface so users can look at the results in real time. Here is a crash report that we can look at. So it shows what crashes there are. Right now, there are many more crashes in head than in 1.189. And at the bottom here on the screen, we can see a backtrace also. And it sorts the backtraces. So the backtraces that are most common are shown at the top. We can look at what warnings are there. This sorts all warnings by ID and shows how many of each we get. Right now in Debian there are 2 million, I think. 2.9 million warnings in total.
How many of those are severe?
I wish I would. I could say that in half an hour or so.
Very
Yeah. Yeah, that must be one of the more common. But there are like hundreds of thousands of undefined behavior warnings. Then we have a time report here. When it scans the source package with 1.89, it will measure the time. And with head, it will measure the time. And as you can see, it fluctuates quite a bit. So it's not that, it's hard to say that if we do a change, if that, sometimes it makes some packages run faster and some packages run slower. So it will differ quite a bit. Yeah?
But not every package is a C++ package in Debian, right? So
no.
You have to filter on which are C++.
We run on both C and C++. So. Yeah. All that is shown here in one.
But the source is tagged. I mean, you can ask the dev tag system.
Yeah, we could group it if we wanted. Yeah. But we don't do that. One common source when it gets a lot slower is when we improve the parser. For instance, template parsing is quite slow. And if we improve that, then code that uses templates will get much slower, but it doesn't affect C code and so on. And we can also sometimes add some syntax checks in Cppcheck, and then the project will get a lot faster if it has such syntax errors. So it's a bit hard to read this report, but it says something. Then we get the diff report where we compare 1.89 and head. And we have not changed any of these checks as far as maybe one of them, but not many here. There are many differences here, even though we don't change the check itself. It's because we always change value flow analysis, we change the parsing, etc. And then that will mean we can detect more bugs or fix some false positives and so on. So this is quite usual. If you look at this number here, it's a summary for today. It says that today 1.89 found 23,000 warnings and head found 20,000. So the number is decreasing, but I hope it's false positives that is decreasing. But we, of course, look at this very carefully. Here is an example report. We can click on each here and get a more detailed report. Here I have shown how a bitwise on Boolean looks like. That one is here. There was 91 warnings in 1.89, and in head there is 600 warnings. So that is like, oh, we must check this. Is this false positives or is it good? Then we get this report. So here, if I wanted to, I have the URLs there and I have the warnings. So I can manually look at one. I can download and unpack and so on manually. But this is quite much work. So we have developed an internal tool that is for Cppcheck developers. It's quite crude, but it works. So then I can double click on each warning and it will show the source code. This will when I double click something, it will automatically download the source code, unpack it, and jump to the relevant file. And in this case, the warning says that we use it would be nice. How do I get back?
It's a presentation.
There. Yeah.
You say that you download and you view the files. Can you handle files that are generated by build scripts and so on?
No, we don't handle that. It's only the source files that are in the code. The analysis doesn't use project files and build scripts at all. We have one Windows package that is analyzed also, and that is Tortoise SVN. And in that case, we use the Visual Studio solution. But anyway, this warning says that Boolean results is used and on a and a bitwise operator is using that. So it's this AND here that it complains about, and that looks reasonable to me. So that's a good find. When you find the Cppcheck 1.90 later, you should run it so you can catch this bug. Okay, any questions? Yes. Yes, that might be that is true. This warning warns about Boolean results used in bitwise operators, but maybe you want to avoid the short circuit and just evaluate both. That is true. So yeah, it might be a false positive. Yeah.
Does this tool only show new warnings, warnings that wouldn't have appeared in 1.89?
That is a good question. We have that is very interesting to know. We have down here a checkbox that says show 100 random results. Then we can show only random results. And then we have an option box here, version. So. So we can choose, do we want to see only head results, or do we want to show only 1.89 results, or do we want to show both? Right now it's both, but this particular list doesn't have any. So we have those are very interesting.
So do people get upset when you point to what you think is bugs?
I don't think upset. I think people understand why we warn mostly. But if they don't understand, it's very easy to It's very important when we write warnings that we are very clear, so people understand why we write the warning. Otherwise, they will always think that it's a false positive, even if we point out a bug. Yes?
Do you adhere to switching off warnings? If you wanted the expression to be this and wanted to say that this is how I wanted to write it, don't warn about this, is that possible?
Yes. I think that Cppcheck has a lot of warnings and it's hard to agree with everybody, every warning. Even I don't agree with every warning, even I suppress some warnings.
Yeah. But you generate your own warnings.
Yes, but if it's a common complaint in the team that this warning should be written, then it can be added, even if I am against it.
Yeah, okay. But can you add something in the code to tag it as?
Yeah. Yeah, you can do that. Yeah. It's you can write a comment.
Oh, okay, and then you don't warn. You parse the comment then.
Yeah. So you have that option. You can also on the command line write a suppression, and you can write in a file suppressions. Yeah? Yes, we do. In the continuous integration, we run Cppcheck on Cppcheck, and we run. It takes about an hour to run the continuous integration.
Well, how many warnings do you have?
I made you suppress.
Yeah. If I now everything will go away again here. That is a list that you can get. Does it want here? Yeah, we can try that. 395. How do you mean with deterministic? If it's yeah, I would say I claim it is deterministic then. The same input will always.
Produce the same results every time.
Yeah, I don't have any, I don't know what.
It's static analysis. So.
Yeah.
Is it deterministic even for the same ast also? Like if I, it doesn't matter if I add new white space or new lines or anything like that. It's
do you mean over time? So, I mean, we always change the value flow. So the same ast will.
Obviously you change stuff, so.
Yeah. Right. We always are changing the output, so yeah. But if you run it, I would say it's deterministic. If you get one ast, that will generate certain warnings always. With this version. Yeah?
How fast is this new setup where you get donated CPU time compared to running it on your laptop? I mean, how often do you go through all the different packages?
It goes up and down quite a bit, but I saw a week ago or so it took 2-3 days to run through all Debian. So it's really faster.
So
So how are the packages distributed? Is it round robin or is it how do you do it?
Sorry, do you mean how I get the packages?
There are like 25,000 packages.
Yeah.
How do you select in which order and how many times each package is analyzed?
I have a very simple script for that. It downloads, there is a FTP where you can download all the packages. There is a ls file that shows the complete directory. So I download that ls file and unpack that and more or less grep for packages. So it's 50 lines of code or something like that. I run it about once a week. So I get updates.
So each request got the next in the list, so to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Having protection against people uploading malicious content to your web server?
I am thinking about that. It's hard to prevent it. I want everybody to be able to donate CPU. So I can't like have a password or hidden secret or stuff. But I'm open to suggestions how to make it a bit more safe. I heard today about include who's. Maybe I will look into that.
Yes, thanks, Babel.